Ladies and gentlemen, dear friends and colleagues, my name is Hamid El Bilali and I am a researcher and consultant at the Department of Sustainable Agriculture, Food and Rural Development, and I am the moderator of this webinar. This is the third webinar of the second cycle of webinars within Feeding Knowledge program. Before going to the main course of today's menu, that is the interview with Dr. Sandro Dernini, let me provide you with an overview about the structure of this webinar. First of all, we will start with a brief presentation about Feeding Knowledge program. Then we will move to the interview. During the interview, you will have the possibility to ask questions, questions that will be collected and answered by Dr. Sandro Dernini during the question time. Of course, in order to give time to Dr. Sandro Dernini to read your questions, we'll have another presentation regarding the fifth research and innovation priority within Feeding Knowledge program. So let's start with the first presentation about Feeding Knowledge program. Well, Feeding Knowledge program is a program on food security in the Euro-Mediterranean area. The rationale behind Feeding Knowledge program is that the best way to identify concrete solutions for food security that really meet the needs of the countries is knowledge development and sharing. The main objective of the program is creating opportunities for dialogue and development through a Mediterranean network of experts focused on research, innovation, and transfer of knowledge for food security. Feeding Knowledge program is structured around five priorities, research and innovation priorities, that are: the first one is sustainable natural resource management. Second, quantitative and qualitative enhancement of crop products. Then, the third priority is about socioeconomic dynamics and global market. The fourth is dealing with the sustainable development of small rural communities in marginal area. And the fifth, that is also the one with which, you know, this webinar is dealing with, is about Mediterranean food consumption patterns, diet, environment, society, economy, and health. The main expected results of the program of Feeding Knowledge program are a Euro-Mediterranean scientific network on research and innovation for food security, the development of an international technology platform that is called Feeding Knowledge, and the creation of 12 focal points to support knowledge development also at the local level, and without forgetting also the importance in order to deal and address the problem of the last kilometer of knowledge transfer, to also to support the national extension and advisory services to transfer research results, and also to listen and to take into consideration the different stakeholders and actors' needs, and to incorporate them in the activities of the program. Well, the fifth, last but not least, result is the support to policymakers for the elaboration of effective policies on research and innovation for food security. The current target area of the project and the program is mainly the Euro-Mediterranean region, with a particular focus on the countries of the Eastern and Southern Mediterranean, that's to say Albania, Algeria, Egypt, Jordan, Iraq, Israel, Libya, Lebanon, Morocco, Palestine, Tunisia, and Turkey. But after 2015, that's to say after the Universal Exhibition of Milan, project activities are planned to progressively involve other regions of the world. Well, in order to achieve the expected result, there were many activities that have been performed. The first one is the organization of open webinars. The first cycle of webinars included five webinars, and they were performed from December 2012 to March 2013. The second cycle, in which this webinar is also included, will include six webinars and will be performed from March 2012 to May 2013. There is the second, also an important activity, is the drafting of five white papers dealing with different research and innovation priorities, and also one policy document dealing with food security in the Euro-Mediterranean area. Also, the international platform www.feedingknowledge.net has been launched. The fifth activity is also the creation of Feeding Knowledge Network that is composed also of sub-networks dealing with the five priorities. Well, you have the opportunity to get involved in different ways. First of all, through social media, that is say Facebook and Twitter, but also by visiting our website. Now, we will have time to see a very short video on Feeding Knowledge program.
Today, food security is still a promise. Knowledge is the way to make it real. Feeding Knowledge will establish an international scientific network for research and innovation, supported by an international technology platform. The network will promote the transfer of knowledge on food security and support policies and programs that really meet the needs of developing countries. In order to build the basis of the Expo Milano 2015 legacy, Feeding Knowledge supports the recognition and dissemination of best sustainable development practices on food security. Feeding Knowledge, international network for research and innovation on food security.
Welcome again. Now we will start the interview with Dr. Sandro Dernini, who is the coordinator of the Forum on Mediterranean Food Culture and also a consultant at the Food and Agriculture Organization of the United Nations. Sandro is got his PhD at the University of New York, and he graduated in biology at the University of Cagliari in Sardinia, in Italy. He has been also the head of the technical office of the president of the Italian National Research Institute on Food and Nutrition. And from 2006 to 2012, he was the scientific coordinator of the CISCAM, the International Inter-University Center for Mediterranean Food Culture Studies, and also he's a member of the International Committee of the Foundation for the Advancement of the Mediterranean Diet of the NGO Nutrition Without Border. Well, Dr. Sandro Dernini, welcome.
Thanks very much to be here.
Well, let's start with the first question. Feeding Knowledge is a program about food security. We know that during the last years, there was a huge progress in terms of food security, but also nutrition security in the Mediterranean. But there are still many problems that should be addressed. So what are, according to you, the main challenges, current challenges, regarding food and nutrition security in the Mediterranean, especially in southern and eastern Mediterranean countries?
Well, is a challenging issue the fact that from in the state of undernutrition we moved to a state of malnutrition for overweight, obesity, micronutrients deficiency that are really touching a lot of the population, especially the younger generation. They are the majority in the Mediterranean, southern, eastern country. So this nutrition transition is creating several problems that are related to the loss of the traditional food pattern that characterized and still characterizes the Mediterranean region, that is the Mediterranean food culture pattern.
Well, so here we are. You have just talked about the Mediterranean diet. And I'm sure that there are many attendees of this webinar that would like to know more about that. So could you explain us a little bit more, what is the Mediterranean diet and what are its main features?
Well, exactly, now we will speak about the Mediterranean diet, but intentionally before I didn't mention the Mediterranean diet, and I spoke about Mediterranean food cultural pattern, because the Mediterranean diet is and has to be an expression of the Mediterranean people, and maybe many does not know that the famous Mediterranean diet, and we are just see in front of us and a graphic representation of a pyramid. This is a new one, is the Mediterranean diet pyramid, that for a long time, until 2009, when we did this new revised pyramid, had and copyright from the United States. So Mediterranean diet does not exist as a one single model. The Mediterranean diet in each country is expressed in different forms. Then the scientific community started to the famous 50s started research on some countries, and they had some common feature that came out of this Mediterranean diet. This the old feature, and they are the classic one, are related to a high consumption of a cereal, fruit and vegetable. Oil, the olive oil, and less consumption of the meat and sweet. But when we revised this pyramid, we felt to insert in the main feature some other element that are on the bottom, two new element. One is that, as you see, people, conviviality, physical activity, local food and cooking, seasonality, that bring the main feature of the Mediterranean diet to the people, to the local reality. Because when I was speaking about the American copyright on the Mediterranean diet, because it was done for export. In this case, We are talking about an food consumption for the people related culturally, physically, with that food production. Well, also another element, sorry, just I finish, is a water. This on the second level, we brought water. It's very important, water as a part of the consumption. And behind the fact that with respect of the religious belief, a moderate consumption of the wine. And I close just to remember the Mediterranean diet, born with the concept of a frugality, small portion. It's not that you can eat large quantity. That are the main feature on which the scientific community found a consensus.
Well, from your answer, I heard I could underline two keywords, people and culture. But that is a little bit surprising for most of us, because when we talk about diet, we think just about food consumption. But it seems that the Mediterranean diet is also a way to recognize a cultural heritage. In fact, it has been recognized in November 2012 as intangible cultural heritage of humanity by UNESCO. So, could you explain us what is the relationship between diet and food cultures in the Mediterranean? But you also mentioned that we cannot talk about only one diet in the Mediterranean, but rather about different diets. So that means also that we have different food cultures in the Mediterranean.
First of all, we have really to remember that we don't eat nutrients, but we eat food. We are not following medical prescription when we approach food. Now, the Mediterranean diet could be a brand name for improve the silhouette, the diet, but it is not. We are eating food. We are, like I said before, we are not eating nutrients. The scientific research was based on nutrient approach. Recently moved to food approach, and now we are finally understanding that also the food-based approach is limited because food is a part of a food system. And we will see during the webinar the development of this concept. But when UNESCO in 2010 acknowledged the Mediterranean diet as an intangible cultural heritage of humanity, it was because Mediterranean diet is under a strong process of erosion and need, therefore, to be safeguarded, because the UNESCO list of the humankind heritage is related to that heritage that is under risk. And this is very important to see the definition of UNESCO, that recall that the meaning of diet in Greek is a life of a way of life, a lifestyle. So it's very important to return that you cannot separate the food from the landscape. You cannot separate the food from the way of cooking, the food from the way how you eat the food, the conviviality. If you eat alone, or if you eat with the family, the community, the friends, it is a different time, is a different metabolism. In this case, if you eat the food that is related to the local, you reduce also the environmental pressure that this food production can cause. But to stay in this moment on the food culture, is that there is a wide awareness in the Mediterranean that food has several characteristics, not only the nutritional, like we said, but for example, social, cultural, and economic. Food, it is the main good trade in the Mediterranean. And in the Mediterranean, now less than before, it was a sense of respect related to food, like not to waste the food to leave on the plate, because in the Mediterranean they cohabit the three main monotheistic religions, you know, the Christian, the Islam, and the Hebrew, that they have religious tradition related to food. In that case, food has more than the dimension of a medical prescription, as it was approached by the nutritionist in the beginning of the 50s, 60s, but like I said, more for a brand name exploitation. And this now we are trying to bring back to us, our culture.
Well, you mentioned while you were answering my last question, different issues, for example, environmental pressure and food system. I will build on that, up on that, in order to make my following question. So we know that sustainability is high on the agenda, and we are also aware of the fact that we cannot reach sustainable development without changing the current consumption pattern, and that food consumption pattern are relevant issues in many sustainability related issues. So my following question is exactly about that. We heard about sustainable diets. So what are sustainable diets? And you mentioned also food system. What are sustainable food systems, and what are the main characteristics? Are we talking about the same thing or different things?
There are many, it's a very complex issue. When we start to research the concept of a sustainable diet, it was an old concept of the 80s. Sustainable diet started to be explored that you cannot separate the health of the people from the health of the planet. But this field of research was abandoned because came more the intensification of the agro-food industry, the intensification of agriculture. So it was only a pressure on the side of production. Then we had the first summit in Rio de Janeiro, the sustainability of the planet, a consumption, the consumer started to be again taken in consideration. So around 2009, at the same time when we did the revision of the Mediterranean diet, we felt that we could really explore again the concept of a sustainable diet to see that there were many characteristics. One that I forgot before to mention was the biodiversity, because for me it's implicit that when we speak about local product, there is also the diversity. It is very important to remember that it does not exist one single Mediterranean diet. There are many different Mediterranean diets, because it does not exist one single Mediterranean food culture, but cultures, plural, because everybody knows that the food culture from Morocco is different from the food culture of Turkey, or the Turkey is very different from the food culture of Greece, and Italy is different from the food culture of Spain, and so on. So all these differences, characteristics, bring also to the sense that you are not eating just for yourself, and you care only about your own health status, but also now, if you consume everything, you are not leaving anything for your future generation. So the concept of a sustainability means that you cannot overconsume the resources that exist. This brought bring together an international group of experts at FAO, we did in 2010, and prepared by an international workshop, by some also survey, and then we arrived to this definition. Sustainable diet are those diets with low environmental impact, which contribute to food and nutrition security and to the healthy life for present and future generations. That is the core now. Sustainable diet are protective and respectful of a biodiversity and ecosystem, culturally accessible, economically fair. That is a very important issue. The cost of the food, because in the moment that you cannot pay now the food fresh, the food that has some kind of quality, you are eating the same food that maybe is high dense energy, but very low quality. Now we have this kind of problem of, we were speaking before, on nutrition transition, where related food chronic diseases are increasing because you are not eating properly, but you are eating, you are not starved, but you are malnourished. In this case, I would like to remember that if from one side today we have 870 million people starved, undernourished, from another side we have 1,200,000 overweight, 400 million obese, and 2 million people that they have macronutrient deficiency. This makes that more than 60% of the population of the world is malnourished. And we have a lot of pressure on the natural resources. So to this point came, and we are still debating, it's not an easy walk, the sustainable diet approach, because there is, of course, a stronger resistance because it touches all these elements, but is in a way to bring it together an holistic approach, different element, because to this point then we will see how you can define, how you can assess a sustainable diet.
Well, so far we have been talking about the Mediterranean diet and also about the concept of sustainability applied to diets, that to say sustainable diets. But I think that it is high time to connect the dots, that's to say, to apply the concept of sustainable diets to the Mediterranean diet. In other words, the question is the Mediterranean diet an example of sustainable diets?
Well, the fact is inverse. Before, in 2009, we did internationally a symposium with a double, twofold agenda. One was to revise the Mediterranean diet pyramid that before we saw, not to have any more an USA copyright, and to bring the other element like conviviality, like biodiversity, like water, like local product, traditional product, that was created like we saw before. The Mediterranean diet today, a model of a sustainable diet. FAO was with us, and we started to promote the concept of a sustainable diet after many, many years that was in standby, thanks to the Mediterranean diet, because the Mediterranean diet is one of the most well scientifically analyzed dietary pattern, and that is acknowledged as one of the most healthy pattern. Second, it started also to be analyzed for its lower environmental impact, especially for greenhouse emission. But the Mediterranean diet covers a large number of countries. So it was an appropriate model to be used as a case study.
Well, my following question is exactly about
that. Sorry, just for a moment, sorry. If we go back to this slide, because still be on the concept, if we see this upside down pyramid, no? That was the point. The Mediterranean diet is based with a high consumption of cereal, fruit and vegetable, and a low consumption of meat and cheese, high protein. So we know the consumption of water, the environmental impact of this production of vegetable, cereal and fruit. But we have still taken consideration the way of the production. It's not a tomato per se that does not increase the footprint. Because if this tomato is produced in a greenhouse, the pressure is stronger. So we have to see that there are a reason why of this double pyramid, the environmental footprint, the element, the main element of the Mediterranean diet, but keep in consideration the way of the production is relevant, and then I come, it's not this full mile, like a kilometer zero, so much important, because that are sometimes slogan that they are. We have really to evaluate step by step the production level to evaluate. This brought, like you were saying before, to bring the need for analyzing the sustainability of the diet. And the Mediterranean diet.
So at this moment, I have to interrupt you, in fact. My following question is about, you mentioned before, you know, that the Mediterranean diet can be as a case, considered as a case study for assessing the sustainability of diet in other regions of the world. So my question is about that. What makes the Mediterranean diet as a good case study for that?
Like I said, there is a large quantity of scientific evidence that analyzes the Mediterranean diet for two main characteristics, the healthy and the environmental. Now, there is, when we speak about sustainability, a sustainable development is built on three pillars of the sustainability. In this case, is the environmental, the economic, and the social. We felt, by dealing with the sustainability of the diet, to bring also the element of course, health and nutrition.
Sorry, sorry, Sandro. In fact, the following question is about that. How we talked about the fact that the Mediterranean diet can be as a good example of sustainable diet, and that it can be also used as an example, a case study for studying the, for assessing the sustainability of diet in other regions of the world. But first of all, we have to get a clear picture about the sustainability of the current food consumption pattern. So, what is the approach that, according to you, should be used, and which dimension of sustainability should be taken into consideration?
The reason why the sustainable diet we started to analyze as a case study, because on these four pillars that I was mentioned, that is society, culture, economy, health and nutrition, and environmental biodiversity, we brought it together because it is part of it. At least we have two pillars. Now, to this point, to assess the sustainability of and consumption pattern, you must have the data. In this case, like I said, we cannot affirm today that the Mediterranean diet is a sustainable pattern, because we are perceiving some modification in the cost of the main food of the Mediterranean diet that are making the Mediterranean diet not accessible as it was in the early 50s when it was started. The Mediterranean diet was a poor diet. It was a diet built on frugality, with, as everybody knows, how much the bread increased the cost, how much fruit and vegetable are increasing the price. We don't want to speak about fish, that there is an overexploited fishery stock, to affirm, to say, the Mediterranean diet is a sustainable diet. This is why, with the SIAM, FAO, we have started to analyze all the different dimensions, these four dimensions, the four pillars, to identify what? Indicators. Because if we don't have the indicators, we don't have also the methodology to measure, to evaluate the situation, the state of art. Of course, this brings other issues, because require some kind of exchange between field specialized that usually they don't talk together. So that is what now we are doing.
Well, so getting an idea about the state of the art, as you said, so about the picture, as I said before, is important, and indicators can help to do that. But we know that we should also make effort to enhance the sustainability of the current food consumption pattern, and also at the same time to safeguard the cultural heritage that is related to the Mediterranean diet. So what are, according to you, the actions, interventions, policy instruments that can be used in order to achieve that utmost objective?
First of all, we have really to change the paradigm, the model of and the methods of analyzing this complexity. And we need some drafting guideline. We need to share the research in long-term information. And it's not because UNESCO acknowledged the Mediterranean diet as a cultural heritage that automatically this means that the safeguard of the Mediterranean diet is guaranteed. No. We have really to bring to a vision of a sustainability means that we needed to enhance the value of our production, of our food, increase an exchange more at the local level by taking consideration the global picture. This new holistic approach that everybody speaks, we don't know exactly what it is, but definitely we still not know how to aggregate the data of this indicator, but for sure we can improve the efficiency of the food system, like to reduce the food losses and food waste. That is really part of the concept of a sustainable consumption and production.
Thank you, Sandro, for this valuable pieces of information. And of course, as you say, there is still a huge effort to be made. This is what we are trying to do with the fifth priority of research and innovation of feeding knowledge. and my colleague Philip Debs will provide us with some insights about the work that has been done.
Thank you, Hamid. As she said, I will give information and introduction about the priority number 5. I will speak also about the stuff and the white paper related to the priority. The priority is entitled Mediterranean Food Consumption Pattern, Diet, Environment, Society, Economy, and Health. Let's start with the stuff that is behind the priority number 5. We have the reference person, Roberto Capone. He's the principal administrator and head of Department of Sustainable Agriculture, Food and Rural Development at the SIAM MAIB. We have also Hamid El Bilali, researcher and consultant at the Department of Sustainable Agriculture, Food and Rural Development at the SIAM. Then there is me, Philippe Debs, researcher and consultant at the Department of Sustainable Agriculture, Food and Rural Development, and Gianluigi Cardone, researcher and consultant at the Department of Mediterranean Organic Agriculture and at the SIAMB. Then we have the reference scientist from the Food and Agriculture Organization of the United Nations, FAO. You already know Sandro Dernini, our FAO consultant and coordinator of the Forum on Mediterranean Food Cultures, Alexander Maybach, senior officer in Agriculture and Consumer Protection Department at the FAO, Barbara Burlingame, principal officer, Nutrition and Consumer Protection Division at the FAO, and Vincent Gilles, coordinator of the high-level panel of experts on food security and nutrition at the FAO. We have also the international experts that are Rekia Bellafsen from Shoaib Dukkali University from Morocco, Elliot Berry, Hebrew University, Israel, Denis Leron, Université Aix-Marseille, France, Xavier Medina, Open University of Catalonia, Spain, Youssef Abu Saleh, Ibn Tufayl University from Morocco, and Golden Pekan, Asettepe University, Turkey. Let me introduce you also our staff that is behind the scene and is helping us a lot in our webinars. We start from the staff of METID from Politecnico di Milano. We have Valeria Baudo, Gianfranco Elia, Paola Corti, and Francesca Concia. And from our Mediterranean Institute, we have Laura Civetti and Marinella Giannelli. The tools that we are using to collaborate with each other and also with our experts are Dropbox, Google Drive, email, and Skype. Let me now speak a little bit about the white paper and its contents. The white paper is divided in several paragraphs. We start with the state of art, and here we speak about the key concepts and paradigms, about the food and nutrition security, where we gave definitions of food security, nutrition security, food security and nutrition, and food and nutrition security, pillars of food security that are the food availability, food access, food use and stability, agricultural systems and food systems, drivers and consequences of food consumption pattern changes, definition of sustainable diets and food losses and food waste. Then also we deal with food and nutrition security in the Mediterranean and in the Middle East and North Africa region. And here we speak about the Global Food Security Index, food affordability, food availability, and food quality and safety. We deal also with the sustainability of the current Mediterranean food system, the Mediterranean diet according to UNESCO, and the new Mediterranean diet pyramid, the nutrition transition in the Middle East and North Africa region, changes of dietary energy and diet composition, and also the pyramids of the food supply. Further, we deal also with the analysis of food-related problems in the Mediterranean region
And here we have 6 points. The first one is the triple burden of malnutrition in the southern and eastern Mediterranean, food-related environmental impact, economic sustainability of the Mediterranean food systems, food losses and waste, erosion of the Mediterranean food cultures, and finally, the governance institutions and policies for Mediterranean food and nutrition security. There is also a list of proposed indicators in order to assess the sustainability of the Mediterranean food consumption patterns, and they cover 5 dimensions, which are the nutrition and health, environment, economy, society, and cultures. And also we have the research needs. The main research themes that are related to the food consumption pattern in the Mediterranean region are the diet, nutritional and health implications, food environmental footprints, food culture and sociology, food system governance, food losses and waste, etc. And then the policy needs. In order to the transition towards a sustainable food consumption system in the Mediterranean region, it requires a comprehensive, coherent, integrated and holistic policies, and within different spheres and arenas of agriculture, health, nutrition, lifestyle, society, environment, biodiversity, and climate change. In order to get involved with our project, you can enter and visit our website, the feedingknowledge.net/it, and then you can follow us also on the Facebook page on Feeding Knowledge and also on Twitter. And now let me also explain in briefly the website of the Feeding Knowledge. When you enter to the website of the Feeding Knowledge, you can see different areas. We have the network, the policy, the best practices that will be launched on May. You have also the database where you can see a list of organizations, scientific actors, research done, and also sources that are related to the 5 priorities, and also the events where you can see our previous webinars and what are the future webinars to be done. And here in each priority, you can enter in the one you are interested in. We enter to the priority 5, and you have to you have a request membership, and when the staff of the Feeding Knowledge give you the access, you can enter, and there you can have the discussion, the document library, where you can find a lot of documents and articles that will be downloaded and are related to each priority. You have also the web conference, and also a little bit of explanation about each priority. Thank you for your attention. I give the floor to Hamid.
Thank you, Philip, for this interesting information about the 5th research and innovation priority of Feeding Knowledge program. So, first of all, I would like to thank, now it's the time for the question time. I know there was a repetition, but no problem. So, and we have 15 minutes for that. First of all, I would like to thank all the attendees for the interesting questions that they asked. We received 8 questions. And all questions, of course, will be answered. But since we have a time constraint, so we will try to answer as many questions as we can. But there will be some questions that we cannot answer now, that we will answer on social media, Twitter and Facebook. Sandro, the floor is yours.
Thanks, Emil. I would like really to pass, if it's possible, I don't know how it's structured, to see all these questions, no? Because before time, number one, by Khaled Sassi on the international level. On the international level, are there strategies that promote the use of the concept of a sustainable diet? Antonio Crisciantelli, the new Mediterranean diet pyramid highlights the importance of consuming local and seasonal agri-food products. Could you elaborate on that? Abel Kader El Hajai, what makes the Mediterranean diet more diversified than do Mediterranean diet system of consumption has the same meaning for developed countries, consumer of those from developing country? Luciano, Lucio, Sisto, what is the relationship between diet diversity and biodiversity in the Mediterranean? Alessandro Riccelli, to consume local seasonal food, we should be sure of the availability of food. It's possible to ensure the availability of food through strategies that are at the same time sustainable, technological advanced. Iowa said poverty is observed to undermine adherence to traditional food patterns. Appreciate a comment on the cost of the adherence to Mediterranean diet, especially in urban situation. I'm very glad that all these questions are very appropriate to give a sense of what we tried to present today, starting from the first. On the international level, are strategies to promote the use of the concept? No, they are not strategies to promote the use. There are a strong debate in the international community, in the scientific community, on what is the sustainable diet. For example, yesterday, 2 days ago, at the FAO, at the Commission Genetic Resources for Food and Agriculture, it was questioned the use of the word in sustainable diet because it does not exist in the international multilateral system of the United Nations, an agreed definition of sustainable diet. That definition that we saw was made an international symposium. We cannot have strategies if we don't have the assessment, if we cannot assess what is a sustainable diet. So the strategies will arrive after. But what will be the strategy if it's of a sustainable diet if it's related to the Mediterranean diet pyramid, for example, that highlight the consuming of a seasonal agro-food product, a local product? That is the tradition. The Mediterranean diet was referred to seasonal product. We didn't create, we didn't invent artificially in the scientific community the use of a seasonal agro-food, the seasonal food product or local product, because it's called rural development. Sustainability, it is part of the famous Agenda 21 that is related to rural development. If the young farmer, they don't feel comfortable anymore to follow the father or the mother, they were small farmer, because there is also the story that a small father is very difficult to survive, and they are not a gratification, there is not any add value, not only economically speaking, but culturally speaking, there will not be any more local product. And if we don't know which are the product of the season, we will import product coming from other part of the world with all the implications that has also economical. And this it is associated to the question what makes the Mediterranean diet more diversified. It's very diversified because it does not exist one single Mediterranean diet. And each Mediterranean diet has its own diversified way to use the local food, and then come to another question that I like more, that there was the number six, that there was, no, number five, sorry, the relationship between diet diversity and biodiversity in the Mediterranean. Because a lot of variety and species are disappearing because they are not used anymore. They are not anymore the diversity. We are also in our country started to eat the same dish that are not respecting any diversity. And that is what we mean when we said that the cultural heritage, the food cultural heritage of the Mediterranean diet is under a risk to be lost. Because it is lost the biodiversity, it is lost the diversity, it is lost the Mediterranean diet. This go very interesting to the concept the number six, Alessandro Riccelli, because it still be related. Because if we don't have that does not is not available this food that we cannot consume, and the food that sometimes need innovation. The research and the innovation and technological advance can only improve, less not to have an Arcadia mythical concept of all the time how good it was, because then nobody will cultivate anymore any land, and we need technological support, we need advanced research to increase sustainable development in the rural dimension. Then we bring the story of the urban that was raised by Aya Wassef. But before, it's very interesting what Riusch erased. First of all, developed country and developing country, they have a different perception of what is. The Mediterranean diet was a brand name, very fancy, to be deeply also associated recently with a nouvelle cuisine. So Mediterranean diet in developed country with a sustainable consumption, there is a lot of waste, a lot of waste that we know for sure that in developing country the food waste is very, very limited, almost is insignificant. While food losses in developing country is high, because when you are poor and you know the value of the food, you don't waste the food. And you have a very careful approach on sustainable consumption. And this Mediterranean diet, in many Mediterranean countries, they don't recognize that their food consumption pattern, it is named by them Mediterranean diet. It's us that we have labeled Mediterranean diet, the kind of food habit followed. But I had a friend from Morocco, that Morocco was one of the four countries that they submitted the candidation to UNESCO, together with Greece, Spain, and Italy. They said that in a very candid way, for us is something very new. So it's not an old tradition to be preserved, the Mediterranean diet, in the Morocco context. But this brings it to the last question of Aya Wassef about the comment on the cost. That is the main issue on the sustainability of the Mediterranean diet from the economic dimension. It is really very critical to assess the cost of the Mediterranean diet menu. Seems to be very prohibitive, seems to be something that has to be carefully remodulated, reassessed, especially in the urban situation. Definitely is a critical situation. And so to give for granted that the Mediterranean diet is equal to the best sustainable approach, really we have to work very hard to aggregate the data that we are collecting and to have a better approach to draft this guideline to promote sustainable food pattern in the Mediterranean area.
Well, thank you once again, Sandro, for answer. I have to say that the question time was really interesting, and I did personally learn a lot. That's why we will try to take into consideration this question during the drafting of the new version of our white paper on food consumption patterns. Well, so here we are. So today's webinar is almost over, but this is a cycle of webinars, so there will be also another one soon, we hope, in the near future. But in order to know more about that, I would like to introduce my colleague Roberta Calieris, that will announce the next webinar.
Thank you, Ami, and good evening to ladies and gentlemen. I represent here the priority tree of feeding knowledge, which is related to socio-economic dynamics and the global market. It's my pleasure and duty to welcome you all to next webinar on May 14th from 3 to 4 in the afternoon. The webinar will be entitled Food Rush, New Commercial Order, Acculturation and New Concept of Poverty. It will be delivered by Professor Felicia Dinolfi from the University of Bologna. Thank you very much for your attention, and now I give back the floor to you, Annette.
Thank you, Roberta, and I would like also to invite all the attendees of today's webinar to attend also the next one. I would like once again to thank all the colleagues that contributed to the success of this webinar, especially our distinguished guests. And time is now for conclusions. So once again, thank you. Hope to see all of you for the next webinar. Have a nice day, and I hope you have enjoyed being with us.